The heavy water reactor will use about 0.7% of the uranium's energy value, and the light water reactor will use about half of 1%. They leave behind two classes of materials. One is the actual fission products. That's what happens when you fission the stuff. Then there is what's called the transuranics. That's what happens when the uranium absorbs the neutron and doesn't fission. It turns into plutonium, americium, and curium, and a few others. Most of it's plutonium. I mean, the overwhelming majority of transuranics are plutonium. So when you talk to people about waste disposal, they say, you know, what's the concern? Well, most of the stuff that's in the fuel is just uranium. It's no more radioactive than it was when you stuck it in. And it's not really a concern. And the fission products, they are very radioactive when they're created, but they decay rather quickly. They don't really have long-term radioactivity. They just decay too fast is the deal. There are a few of them that have very long half-lives, but that means their radioactivity levels are extremely low and they just don't really pose a hazard. The real challenge with spent fuel management is the presence of those transuranics, plutonium, americium, curium, because they have moderate half-lives and they have complicated decay chains. When you're looking at like a Yucca Mountain or a disposal site, you go, what are we going to do with that? Well, the basic advantage of LFTR over that approach is we don't form those transuranics. We burn up essentially all of the fuel in this process because we don't remove fuel from the reactor until it's a fission product. General idea is you don't want uranium or thorium or anything else to end up in your waste stream, and that's a pretty straightforward proposition in this fluid-fueled reactor. So our waste story is a lot different. You can also then turn around and go back and take some of the waste that's already been created in our uranium-fueled reactors and potentially destroy those long-lived transuranics through fission. You know, waiting them out to decay is a very slow process. Plutonium-239, for instance, has a 24,000-year half-life. So that's a long time you're going to be waiting for that to decay. On the other hand, you can fission it, and then those fission products will decay very rapidly, and you'll also get an energy release and a neutron release, both of which are good.
1,000 kilograms of U-233, which is roughly what we've got. You know, 90% of that will fission. We can make about $500-600 million in the electricity, another $50 or $60 million on the fission of the uranium-235. Almost all of it will ultimately end up fissioning. Out of about 1,000 kilograms, about 15 kilograms of plutonium-238 will be left over. Now, this is good stuff. NASA is desperate for this stuff. This is plutonium-238 is different than plutonium-239, the stuff we use in bombs. In fact, it's worthless for bombs.
These radioisotope thermoelectric generators are based on plutonium-238, and this is the only way that we've been able to explore the outer solar system. The United States is unique, the only country in the world that has sent space probes beyond the asteroid belt. And it's all been based on having this technology. Short answer, we're out of the stuff. It's gone. We've used it all up. The Russians used to sell us some. They've sold us all their inventory. It's gone. NASA's got billions of dollars of deep space missions hinging on having enough of this stuff to run the batteries to let the thing call home. We will be able to make this in LFTR. If you've heard sometimes about us saying, we burn up 99% of the fuel and there's 1% left, the 1% left is that stuff. And it's worth almost as much as the stuff we burn up.
In addition, it would make medical molybdenum-99.
We are about to shut down the one reactor in Canada that is making molybdenum-99 for medical purposes in 2015. There are hundreds of thousands of patients that will not be able to get their molybdenum-99 that they need for diagnostic procedures when that happens. We can make molybdenum-99 just in normal course of operation, and we can remove it very easily.
We have a 3-year environmental assessment process in Canada to build a nuclear reactor, and we have a weekend to produce a coal plant.
Coal and gas plants are able to release radioactive materials to the environment in much greater amounts than a nuclear plant would ever possibly be allowed to, because they are considered what's called NORM, naturally occurring radioactive materials. For instance, when you go frack a shale and you pull gas out, a lot of radon comes out with that too. You burn the gas, that radon's being released. Nobody counts that radon against the gas. If they did, the regulatory commission would shut the gas plant down. Same with coal. Coal contains small amounts of uranium and thorium. They go up the stack, they're dispersed.
Why they can't tell you how much waste they produce.
Yeah, and they've spent a lot of money to make sure that regulatory agencies do not regulate NORM for a coal or a gas plant the way they regulate radioactive emissions from a nuclear plant. If they did, we would be shutting down all our coal and gas plants based on radioactivity alone.
Even if linear no threshold was actually true, let's say for a minute it was true, this was the reality of the world, you would still be much better off establishing an entire world powered by nuclear power. And the reason why is because of the radioactive releases from coal. You would want to shut down coal so you could have nuclear, because coal releases more radiation than nuclear by several orders of magnitude. The notion there's no safe amount of radiation, that is not a substantiated or even an accurate statement. It is probably actually utterly inaccurate, but it is commonly found as a basis of public policy around the world.
That was my understanding until just now. It was that there was no safe level of radiation.
Two great books on this, Terrestrial Energy by Bill Tucker and The Power to Save the World by Gwen Cravens, go into this topic extensively and tell this notion of low exposure levels of radiation is addressed and put to bed, it will forever dog the nuclear industry.
A sunburn is radiation damage. That's radiation burn. We don't call it that, but that's what it is. Your body is responding, trying to prevent further radiation damage, ionizing radiation to your skin and your cells, and it's generating melanin, which is a natural shielding mechanism. You don't want to let anybody get too much radiation dose at any one time, and the radioactivity that we get from nuclear reactors is extremely small in comparison to the radioactivity we're getting from other sources. Biggest one being radon. You know, there's a radioactive gas that's coming out of the ground all the time, and you're breathing it right now. It is responsible by far for the majority of the radioactivity that your body receives. You know, it's just the planet we live on.
Inside the Earth, thorium and uranium are decaying, and they're decaying very slowly, but there's a lot of them, and the Earth is big. They produce most of the heat that drives the internal processes of the Earth. They produce the heat that drives plate tectonics. They produce the heat that drives the generation of the magnetic field. If we didn't have the energy from thorium, we wouldn't have carbon recycling in the crust. Bigger deal, the magnetic field, because the magnetic field is deflecting the solar wind. If you don't have a magnetic field deflecting the solar wind, over billions of years your planet ends up like Mars, because the solar wind will strip off a planet's atmosphere without the protecting nature of the magnetic field. So if we didn't have the energy from thorium inside the Earth, we would be on a dead planet. Fun thing I tell people, I say, what's green energy? And they go, geothermal's green energy. Do you know where geothermal comes from? No. It comes from decay of thorium inside the Earth. Is geothermal renewable? Yes. Okay, then thorium's renewable. No, it's not. You're using it up. Well, you're using up thorium as it decays inside the Earth, too. So any argument for geothermal, if it is rigorously pursued, is an argument for the renewability of thorium as an energy resource. And I love to have that debate. They usually change the rules on me as I get into it. But good one to play on your friends if they start giving you a hard time for coming to a protospace and talking about thorium. You can say, dude, it's green energy. What?